Today I'm really excited about this video because it's on a topic that I absolutely love talking about, and that is marriage. And if you're wondering, how does marriage and a conversation about marriage tie into homemaking? Honestly, I think it's one of the biggest topics that really goes hand in hand with homemaking as a Christian. And the reason for this is because in Titus, Paul is writing to Christians at a church, and he's telling them these are the priorities. These are what's super important. So he tells the older women, the women that are more mature, the women that have been Christians longer, what they should be teaching the younger women that have maybe just became Christians, what their priorities should be. And so I want to read this to you because this shows this is not a small thing. This should be one of our main focuses. And so this is what Paul says, that they, the older women, admonish the younger women to love their husbands. That is the very first thing they say. And then they go on to loving their children, being keepers of the home, and so much more. So today, that is what we're going to be discussing. We're going to be discussing, as homemakers, how can we love our husbands well? And this video is going to be slightly different because in videos past, I've shared more like personal opinions and things I do personally to hopefully better our marriage. But these things are all things I've learned either from my mom, who was married for about 30 years before my dad passed away, and from Elisabeth Elliot, who just has a wealth of knowledge. And so the only things I'm going to be sharing that are my own is just how I apply these things in our marriage personally. I don't know about you, but when I watch a marriage video on YouTube, I am looking for something so hard, it's like almost impossible to do. And the reason for that is just because I find it so much more motivating. So let's just jump in first to some of the things that my mom has shared with me, ways that she set examples for me as far as how a good wife is, and then we'll move on to some of Elisabeth Elliot's stuff that I find incredibly inspiring and incredibly hard. The first thing is fairly simple, and I watched my mom illustrate this so well with my dad. My mom always catered to my dad, and she did this with food, she did this with the way she dressed, she did this with the way that our home looked. They catered to each other, but in particular, my mom always made my dad the priority in what she did and what she chose to make and what she chose to wear. And it's interesting because I do think you'll find this to be true. If you observe really healthy, happy marriages, it's always because the spouses cater to each other. And I think it's so important. And so in my own marriage, this is something both my husband and I apply to each other. My husband's catered to me a whole lot with the houses that we've lived in, with allowing me to pick out the decor, me to pick out some of the styles. But I've also catered to him. And so if he doesn't like something that I wear, I don't wear it a second time. If he doesn't like something I cook, I don't cook it a second time. Or at least I try not to. I cook it on nights he's gone. And it's just a super simple, easy way to show your spouse you value their opinion and value their needs above your own. She never tried to preach to or convert my dad. And growing up, my dad was not a Christian for the first quite a few years of their marriage. And yet, I never saw my mom preaching to him. She lived out a quiet life like the Bible teaches of how a wife can win her husband to Christ, and didn't try to convert him. She just lived by example. And I think that is what eventually persuaded my dad to actually become a Christian. And I heard some lady say one time, "You are not your husband's Holy Spirit. You are there to love him and to take care of him, but you are not there to be his Holy Spirit." And you guys, as bad as it sounds, I have tried to be my husband's Holy Spirit before, and it has always gone very poorly. So in my own life, how I'm trying to apply this is just to pray for my husband more, pray for those areas, pray for things that I think he should change, and allow God to do the work. And just be his lover and his supporter so that he, in return, can love me correctly and doesn't feel I'm his mom or feel I'm being a nag. The third thing that I can learn from my mom is that I never once heard her compare my dad to another man. And I think this benefits your marriage in so many ways because, number one, you're not making your spouse feel insecure. And number two, you're focusing on all the traits your spouse has rather than focusing on all the traits other people have and therefore becoming discontent or really not observing and being thankful for the exact traits you married your spouse for.
I truly think no matter how wonderful your spouse is or how many amazing traits they have, when you start to compare, you immediately stop noticing those. And so I really encourage you, if there's podcasts you listen to or movies that you watch or books that you read or people that you hang around with that you find you're constantly measuring your husband to and wishing they had these other traits or wishing you were married to someone else, cut those things out of your life and start focusing on all the traits in your spouse that you fell in love with in the first place. Number four that I watched my mom illustrate so well in her marriage to my dad, but I also watched another lady that I highly respect who's been married a good 30 or 35 years share as well, was to let go of control and surrender your spouse to God. And early on in our marriage, this just took the form of allowing my husband to take overtime shifts. It sounds kind of dumb, but it was something I wanted to control him in. I wanted him to have those guaranteed days off every week. And it's an area that gradually I've learned to just, if he wants to work more, allow him to work more. Stop trying to control him. And this doesn't mean that I never tell him, hey, I feel like we haven't spent time together. Could we please have a day to just spend family time together? It doesn't mean that, but it does mean that I love him in a totally different way when I allow him to be who he is. And you know what? There are times when, as wives, we think we know better than our spouse, and I think there are times when we 100% do, but there are also times when I could be wrong and he could be right. And so allowing God to be the one to speak to Danny, which then opens me up to just love him in the way that I was made to love him, is so freeing. And it makes your love for your spouse not hinge on what decision they make. And so I think it's a really important one and a hard one to learn. It's hard for me to learn, but it is very, very important. And I think it's very valuable. And I think my mom illustrated it really, really well. All right, so along with all this, I have been reading Elisabeth Elliot's books, and I have found them so challenging. Some of the best, most wonderful books I've read in a very, very long time. So these are a few things that she mentions in her books that just really, really challenge me. The first one, she said, she has this beautiful quote that talks about forsaking self-pity or forsaking being offended. And I just felt immediately challenged because honestly, this is probably one of the biggest weaknesses I tend to bring into our marriage that causes probably 99.9% of our arguments and our fights that are not necessary. So I chose after reading this quote for 1 week to not be offended by anything that happened. And so typically I can be offended by the most ridiculous of things, a joke that was said that when we were dating, I would have not been bothered by for an instant. It's like I'm almost looking for a reason to take offense, which is so embarrassing and not the type of person that I want to be. I don't want to be looking to have a bad day. That is not who I want to be. I am not a victim. Or else it could have been something as simple as we're both super tired. And so Danny's a little bit more sharp. And I do this so often too. If I'm really frustrated with Carrie, I'll lash out at Danny in a way that is totally unkind and unnecessary. But I'm exhausted and I'm tired and he always has grace with me through it. And yet when he does it back, I immediately can take offense to it. And it's interesting because I'll actually observe and I'll notice I'll have this moment where I get to decide. Am I going to be offended and ruin our entire day? Or am I going to choose not to be offended and have a fabulous day? So I chose for 1 week not to be offended. There is one time in this week that something came up that actually genuinely hurt my feelings. And it was a dumb little thing about what I keep in our kitchen as far as dishes go because Danny was helping me cook. And so usually I would have stewed over that probably the entire day and been frustrated and have my feelings hurt. But instead, I only have two options. I either immediately choose, you know what, this is not a big deal, I'm going to move on with it, or, you know what, this kind of genuinely bothered me, and so I need to address it immediately. We moved on and had a fabulous day. You guys, this is life-changing. Since then, I've been doing it about a month now, and I have just felt our communication has totally changed. I have been happy and in love and just so pumped up about marriage and life and us every single day since this has happened. And so I strongly encourage you, let go of that control and choose to not be offended by things that were not meant to offend you. and just choose to love your spouse and give them grace, just like the grace you want to receive when you're stressed or you're tired or your baby is screaming its head off. It's funny because when I made this decision to do this challenge, it was like prying control out of my hands and prying excuses to be angry from my grasp. And now I'm like, what on earth was I thinking? I never want to go back. Never. I strongly encourage you, if you are the type that tends to be offended about little things and be overly sensitive about things that don't matter, let it go. You actually can. I'm shocked, but you can. All right, this next one comes from Elisabeth Elliot's book called Let Me Be a Woman, and I find it so challenging. It's in the chapter called You Married a Sinner. And so this is the first part that I want to read. But you will find yourself totally disarmed, and your accusing spirit transformed into loving forgiveness the moment you remember that you did, in fact, marry a sinner, and so did he. It's grace you both need. And then this is another part. So you married a sinner, and you love, accept, and forgive that sinner as you yourself expect to be loved, accepted, and forgiven. You know that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and this also accuses your husband, who has come short also. This is such a good reminder because I've found, going back to taking offense so easily, that oftentimes for myself, I can completely excuse actions that when Danny does them, suddenly I'm so judgmental of and so critical of. And so this is just a really challenging thing for me to remember, that I need to love Danny the way I expect to be loved, the way that I am expecting him to love me. And I also need to be forgiving about ridiculous little things. It kind of goes back to taking offense, that there's no reason to hold on to resentment and bitterness over. All right, so this last part that I wanted to read and talk about from Elisabeth Elliot is also from the book Let Me Be a Woman. And so for those of you who don't know about Elisabeth Elliot, her husband, her first husband, and her were missionaries, and he was actually killed by the tribe he was trying to witness to. And so she went on for a long time after that, being a widow. I think it was about 13 years. And so she really has this deep understanding of what it is that us wives can take for granted. And so when she met, I believe it was her second husband, they were dating, and she has this quote in here that I thought was so beautiful. I told this man I knew that there were women waiting for him who could offer him many things I could not offer, things like beauty and money. But I said, there's one thing I can give you that no other woman on earth can outdo me in, and that is appreciation. The perspective of widowhood had taught me that. And then there's this other part in here that I found extremely beautiful as well. And she said, how often I've sat in a room full of people and I've heard a wife contradict, criticize, belittle, or sneer at her husband before the rest of the company. And I've had with difficulty restrain myself from leaping from my chair, going over and shaking that woman by the shoulders and saying, do you realize what you've got? She doesn't. She hasn't my perspective, of course. If only there were some way for every wife to have the experience of losing her husband for a little time, even of thinking that he's dead, in order to regain the perspective she needs for genuine appreciation. The first time I read this, I think I just cried because I realized I don't appreciate my husband as much as I should. And I don't want it to have to take him passing away, him dying of some accident, for me to wake up from a fog realizing I could have appreciated all of these things about him I totally took for granted and never thanked him for. And I found a couple of weeks ago even, I was praying and I just said, Lord, help me to appreciate something new about Danny that I haven't noticed before. And immediately this thought came into my head of, I've never appreciated the fact that he's allowed me to stay home with Caroline. I've never thanked him for that. It's always just been a given. It's just always been something we planned on doing. And yet I know there are a lot of husbands out there that would want the extra income, want their wife out there working and making extra money. And it was just a really simple, easy way that I was able to immediately realize this is something I've never been grateful for, never thanked my spouse for, and I was able to thank him. And so I realize we get used to our spouses, we get used to their traits, we get used to their characteristics, and it's easy to take certain things about them for granted that at the starting of our relationship. Maybe it was the very things we fell in love with. And I think all of these things direct our heart towards a heart of appreciation and a heart of gratitude towards our spouse and just who it is that they are.